So, this video is sponsored by Wondershare. PDF Element is a software developed by Wondershare, providing one of the smoothest, fastest, and most seamless experiences in creating, editing, annotating, and converting PDF files. In short, PDF Element is a much more affordable alternative to PDF editors such as Adobe Acrobat. It's available across all platforms, macOS, Windows, Android, and iOS. So, let me show you some of the features. Do you want to turn a scanned document into an editable file where you can make adjustments using the OCR feature? PDF Element. You want to maybe create a form where you can fill in text boxes, tick checkboxes, fill in dropdowns, and maybe even add a digital signature. A digital signature that includes pinpoint information about your client. You want to do all that? PDF Element. With the use of data extraction, do you want to now export all of this interactive data into a spreadsheet? PDF Element. Do you want an affordable software that performs obviously the basics, but also these pro-like features? One word. PDF Element. A big thanks to Wondershare for sponsoring this video. Alright. These are two of the biggest players in the game, and I want to talk to you about them. So yeah, let's do that. Okay, first off, from a general perspective, these two phones are clearly catered to two different audiences, because at the end of the day, they're two very different products, but they have one key point in common that isn't shared between many phones, which for me is what makes this an interesting comparison. Because from the two audiences of people looking to buy these phones, both of them are pro users, and that's the key point. Now, what does it mean to be a pro user? To me, it simply means that you do more than what the average person does with a smartphone, and therefore want to buy one of these two phones. But what's interesting is I consider each of these phones pro for different reasons. So my question to you is, which feature set within each of these phones works better for you as a pro user? Because they both have pro-based feature sets. The Fold, for example, well, it's very, very clear. It's a tablet that's also a phone, and it's pocketable. And what makes it pro is that you're getting these tablet features on a mobile device. That's what makes it pro. And we can dive into that, which we will. You know, the multitasking, all of that. That's what makes it pro. But on the other hand, all the other aspects in a Fold aren't exactly pro. But that's where the Note 20 Ultra comes in. The Note 20 Ultra has the same general form factor as most phones today, or what we would consider to be a standard phone. It's a slab with a screen on the front and a camera on the back. Now, other than the fact that it's running Snapdragon, which makes it pretty good, but I mean, most high-end Androids use the latest Snapdragon anyway, so that doesn't necessarily mean anything, but it is good, and it's powerful, and it's gonna handle a game without a doubt like bread on butter. But the pro feature set of the Note 20 Ultra is, well, A, the obvious, the S Pen. The number of functional uses this adds to certain people is immense, and that's what can make it pro. How about the camera? Well, it records at 8K. It's not perfect, but I would definitely consider it a pro camera. It's entering a territory of technical specifications and capabilities that the average high-end phone doesn't even attempt to reach to. The way I would describe the Note is that it grabs everything from the normal average high-end smartphone and increases it. That display, instead of keeping it relatively close to the corners, it expands it to the very edge. That extra space inside your phone? Why not fit a stylus in there? That camera on the back? Let's do something different. That's what makes the Note pro. And the question that you need to be asking yourself is, which pro-like feature set suits your needs more? The pocketable tablet or the extremist phone? Now let's look at specifics. We've already covered the form factor, not to mention they both have a frosted matte back, which is so good. But let's look at both displays. So the Z Fold obviously has two displays, one of which is a 7.6-inch foldable dynamic AMOLED 120Hz display with a resolution of 1768x2208. Quick explanation, 120Hz basically means that the screen refreshes 120 times per second. And then the outer display of the Fold is a 6.23 inch Super AMOLED 60Hz display with a resolution of 816x2260, which can be justified because it's a very narrow display. And then the Note 20 Ultra has a dynamic AMOLED 2x 6.9 inch 1440p 120Hz display. 1440p is the resolution, which can in other words be 2K in comparison to 4K. And look, they're both made by Samsung. They're both very nice displays. But the problem is with the Fold, each display has a compromise. The outer display obviously has the compromise of 60Hz because they want to keep that price low, so they're making it a little bit worse than that inner display. It's also very, very narrow. And then the inner display, well, that has a crease and it gets filled with fingerprints. It's very delicate. Overall, the substance of the display, like the general usage in practice, isn't exactly the same as the Note's. Because the Note has a very, very solid, truly immersive edge-to-edge display, and I mean edge-to-edge display, that fills the entire front of the phone with 120Hz. It's glass, it's super durable, feels very, very solid. And like, there are other technical things that just make it look that bit better. But realistically speaking, those extra little enhancements aren't really a big deal. It's just kind of the fact that it's a very immersive and solid and flat usable display that makes it better than the Fold's display from a technical aspect. But then again, in terms of functionality, which one's better? Well, we gotta kind of give it to the Fold. The Fold does kind of have a problem where the inner display is a bit too big and the outer display is a bit too small, so there isn't the perfect in between, and that from a functional aspect does have its drawbacks. But if you're getting a Fold, then you're probably getting it because you want that big display. And that's a big, big pro, isn't it? Because you, as I say, have a foldable tablet where you can do so much multitasking. You can run 4 apps right next to each other. When watching content, you're getting a much bigger viewfinder. You're then also getting the benefits of having a foldable phone. The fact that it folds in half gives you other features such as tent mode or flex mode. Tent mode being the outer display is facing you as if it's on a stand, and then flex mode being the form in which the Fold is kind of set like a laptop, and then you can use both sides of the screen. One for watching the YouTube video, one for scrolling through comments, or one for taking a picture, and one for the actual viewfinder of the image. And as time passes, more apps will be taking advantage of this, and this is where the pro for the Fold really does come in, because you can't do that with any other phone at the same capability and efficiency that you can do it with the Fold. So basically, for displays, as a conclusion, from a technical aspect, yes, the Note 20 is better. It's nicer to look at, and it's kind of nicer to use in that sense. But from a functional and like cool factor aspect, definitely the Fold, because that's what makes it pro, and there's nothing like it. Now, as the display was the pro feature of the Fold, the pro feature of the Note, as I explained earlier more generally, is obviously the form factor and its increasing basic characteristics of the phone, such as the camera, display, whatever. But the main thing for the Note that no other phone has is the stylus, is the S Pen. And if you really need that, you probably know who you are. If you want it, then you probably also know who you are. But the S Pen also gives you an entirely new functional purpose that no other phone can do. You can mark things up, you can sign up, you can be more efficient, pinpoint more with your pen when you're trying to be a little bit more direct or tidy in something, whatever that thing is. It also has the benefits of working as a controller, which isn't 100% a gimmick. It's definitely one of those things you're not going to use often, but it's not a gimmick, because I know there's going to be situations where you could really save the day with that feature. That doesn't necessarily make it pro though, but you know, that's just a plus to what's already there. So yeah, that's the S Pen. If we were to look at the speaker and microphone, then something I want to state is both phones have the microphone placed in a horrible position because they're super easy to block and it's super annoying. But the speaker, on the other hand, well, on the Note 20 Ultra, the speaker is kind of the same deal. It's in a horrible position when you're kind of leaning the phone on your chest or something, then you're gonna block that speaker in the Note 20 Ultra. But for the Fold, it's got a speaker on the top and a bottom, and I'm not saying one of the speakers is an earpiece. It's got two individual speakers, one on the top, one on the bottom, and they work very, very well. So the Fold wins there. They're both very uncomfortable in your pocket because they're both very tall, but this only applies when you're sitting down. So Note 20 Ultra, obviously massive. When you're sat down, it's kind of jagging into you. Same thing applies to the Z Fold 2 because it's so narrow and long. It's jagging into you as well when you're sitting down. But something that a lot of people care about is battery life. And battery life isn't as simple as it sounds when it comes to these two phones, because it depends. Now, one of the major pluses of the Z Fold 2 is it only comes with a Snapdragon processor, rather than only having the Snapdragon processors in the US and then Exynos everywhere else. So that was a solid move from Samsung for doing that. But if you are not in the US, then you're going to be getting an Exynos processor in your Note 20 Ultra, which is super annoying, because Exynos basically means you're going to get worse battery life, slower phone, and an overall worse experience. Now, I'm not saying a terrible experience, especially in speed, they pretty much feel the same. I'm just saying it's worse. But then when it comes to battery life, that's when it's bad for Exynos. So if you're getting your phone from outside the US, then the battery life is 1,000,000% gonna be better in the Z Fold 2. But if you're getting your phone from the US, then both of your options are Snapdragon, then the Snapdragon Note 20 Ultra will definitely be better than the Snapdragon Z Fold 2. Though, having said that, the Z Fold 2's battery life is really not that bad. Now, with the complexity of the display on the Fold, you can't really have an in-display fingerprint, which is why they opted for a power button fingerprint. On the right side of the phone, within the power button, is a fingerprint scanner, whereas on the Note 20 Ultra, it's an in-display fingerprint. Now, which one is cooler? Let's be honest, it's the Note 20 Ultra. It's definitely cooler. But which one is better? Without a doubt, it's the Z Fold 2. Now, I truly never expected to be saying this, but the fingerprint and the power button is so much better. The only times where it can be annoying is when it's on a desk where you gotta do some finger thumb gymnastics to try and reach the power button. Or if you're left-handed, which in that case, your thumb won't be naturally lying onto the power button, which will get very annoying. But if you're not left-handed, then generally this is much better in my opinion. It's faster and it's more convenient. You don't even have to think about it. But then having said that, the Note 20 Ultra's fingerprint isn't terrible, it's just not as good as the Z Fold 2's. Now, I'm gonna be straight up with you. When it comes to the camera, the Note 20 Ultra completely blows the Fold out of the window. Not only in practice, but also from a technical standpoint. Why is that? Well, it's because of the 108 megapixel main camera that the Note 20 Ultra has. What does that mean? That means that the Note 20 Ultra is capable of taking images with 108 million pixels as opposed to 12 million pixels on the Fold and most other phones. So obviously that allows for really high quality images with a lot of detail. On top of that, it also allows for 8K video recording, basically meaning 8,000 pixels across the width of the video, which most professional cameras don't even do. Now obviously, because it's a new thing and it is being adapted to work in a smartphone, it's not perfect. Like, there's a lot of flaws with it, but I think it's really interesting, it's really cool, and it does a pretty good job. So let me show you some of the shots. And by some of the shots, I mean the 8K, so you can judge for yourself, because I think the 8K here is pretty crispy. And stabilization is really bad, but as I say, not perfect. Now I'm only showing you some of the shots, I'm not actually doing a camera comparison here, because there are many other videos that do that way better than this one. So go check out a Fold versus Note 20 Ultra camera comparison if you want to see that. Or check out my Note 20 Ultra review and my Z Fold 2 review and see my camera previews from there. But yeah, that's kind of a look at some of the shots. I don't want to make any comments on it, so you can just judge for yourself, fully your opinion, and I don't want to influence my opinion onto you. But yeah. Now, as a conclusion, in terms of justification for the price, $1,300 for the Note 20 Ultra, I don't justify. Now, I definitely think you should pay a premium for the Note 20 Ultra, but $1,300 is just too much. But then again, there's no phone like it, so. But then for the Fold, that's $2,000 or £1,800, which I'm gonna justify. Why? Now, look, it's a crazy amount of money, I'm not gonna deny that, but there is no phone like it, and considering the time period, considering it's absolutely new technology, then it makes sense. And the fact that it's going down every year shows that there is kind of an effort there in lowering the price. But which one should you buy? Well, that circles back to what I said at the beginning about which pro feature set works best to fulfill your needs efficiently and positively so you can get everything done the best way possible. That's the one that works best for you, and only you can know that, so that's why I leave the decision up to you. But yeah, that's kind of my overall conclusion and standpoint out of all of this. It's pretty much the same as it was in the beginning, and it kind of reflects a lot on what I said at the beginning. Anyway, I really hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please subscribe, leave a like and comment as well, because that helps with the algorithm. I'm trying to hit 10k by the end of the year. And if you haven't checked out my Instagram at El-Naggar, that would be highly appreciated. A lot of behind the scenes, that kind of thing, you know what's coming up next on the channel. So yeah, that's it. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I will see you in the next one. So then.
Thank you.